Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Safety Net, Brookline Interactive's group cable television station's show dedicated to educating and reflecting on domestic violence. As you all probably know, October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, which means we educate, we reflect, and if necessary, if you see something, say something. And remember, domestic violence is a crime. In honor of Domestic Violence Awareness Month, we are so lucky today to have Sheriff Jerry McDermott, Sheriff of Norfolk County, as our guest on the Safety Net. Welcome, Sheriff.
Susan, thank you so much for having me, and looking forward to talking about this very important topic and something that when I became sheriff, it seemed that the floodgates opened with phone calls from affluent neighborhoods in Norfolk County. And I have to be honest, Susan, I was stunned at the number of calls that I received.
Sheriff, tell us a little bit about your background and how you came to be sheriff of Norfolk County, and we're so lucky to have you.
Well, thank you. So a little bit about my background. I was born at St. Elizabeth's Hospital in Brighton, not too far from Brookline. And I was brought up there in Oak Square, Brighton, and graduated Catholic Memorial High School and the University of Mass at Boston. Fast forward to my time when I served on the Boston City Council. I was on there for about 6 years, three terms. And it was during that time, Susan, that I saw a lot of young people getting hooked on heroin and passing away. And I went to too many wakes and funerals. And it was all related to the prescription drug abuse, the painkillers, like Percocet and OxyContin. And, you know, I had to do something about it. So around 2004, I actually said that we have to go after Purdue Pharma. I was one of the first municipal officials in the country to call out Purdue Pharma and say, we absolutely have to investigate the overprescribing of these opioids. And it was that, I think that effort back in 04 that led me to become sheriff, because all the different things that happened in life between 2004 and 2018, when I was appointed by Governor Baker, I think were really preparing me for the position. And when I sat with the governor and we talked about the vacancy, because the former sheriff, Mike Velotti, had left, the governor said, look, you know, I don't necessarily need to appoint somebody with law enforcement background. I need somebody who understands recidivism, who understands this opioid crisis, and is really going to help people not relapse. And that's what we've been doing. We've got some really forward-looking programs, including medication-assisted treatment, the MAT program, M-A-T. I was one of the only sheriffs to step up and say, we'll do that. And it's been working out great, helping people with not just prescribing them drugs, Susan, but also robust counseling so that we can wean them off the illicit drugs they were using out on the street.
Sheriff, can you tell us a little bit about the jail or the House of Correction? How many inmates, how many are there now? What, if you know this, what percentage of inmates are there due to domestic violence incidents? And sure. I'm going to ask you a question later on. What is your prescription for cutting down on the domestic violence incidents? But anyway, if you could just fill us in briefly on the jail.
Absolutely. So we run both the jail and House of Correction. So we have sentenced and pre-sentenced population, as well as some U.S. Marshal detainees. So today we're about 384 men and about 21 women.
Yay.
Yes. Now for the men.
Yay, thank you.
Two-thirds of them are actually pre-sentenced. So they're waiting for their day before the judge. But we offer everyone the medication-assisted treatment while we have them. And this is why. The people in our care and custody, 80% have a dual diagnosis, some underlying mental health issue. It could be schizophrenia, bipolar, anxiety, depression. But they have some underlying mental health issue plus a substance use disorder. That's a staggering number, 80%.
Mm-hmm.
And just to op-ed for a minute, I think that we need a larger conversation here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts around mental health hospitals again. You know, not too far from where I live in Westwood, we have the Medfield State Hospital. It's going to be condominiums and a mixed-use development. And we have sold off so many assets. And I think we do need to talk about having state-run facilities again with all the safeguards that we can put in place now in 2020. that weren't there decades ago when some of the abuses happened at mental health hospitals. But the people who come into our care and custody, oftentimes their loved ones weren't equipped to take care of them. They took themselves off their prescribed medicines, ended up on the street, abusing alcohol, abusing hard illicit drugs. And that, yeah, they get court involved quick and they end up in our care and custody. So we have a robust behavioral health and mental health, behavioral health and medical team, and we address their needs. For the women, Susan, the women that come into our care and custody used to be sent to MCI Framingham, which is
state
not
prison.
Awful place. It wasn't fair, it wasn't equitable, was not fair treatment for women. So the women involved in the justice system were shipped to MCI Framingham. And when I became sheriff, I said, no, we're going to end that practice. It's not fair. I made a compact with Suffolk County Sheriff Steve Tompkins. And now the women are at a county facility getting the same opportunity at all the rehabilitation programs as the men.
Long overdue, Sheriff. Long overdue.
And Susan, you won't be surprised. A high percentage, I'm going to say it's around 40 to 45, and that fluctuates, 40 to 45% of the people in our care and custody are in there for domestic violence.
So that's it might high.
It may be other charges plus, but it all depends on what they're going to plead to, especially in the, when you're talking pre-sentenced. Their lawyers tell them don't admit to anything. So we can't even start any anger management classes or try to work with them because they don't want to say they did anything. 99% of them will say, she's crazy. She's made up the charges. I didn't do it. They do not want to admit any guilt. And I'm sure that they're being coached.
Sheriff, that's a problem because the court appointed programs for batterers require, and I'm a defense attorney, require the individual to admit. If they don't admit, Sheriff, their probation's violated. There's something not, you don't have to respond to this, but there's something not right there. So we need other programs that will help those who are involved stop being involved. I don't know what they are, and I've been doing this for 30 years, but maybe you have some ideas. One is the family reunification program you have for the women and their kids, or the victims and their kids, because it isn't always women.
That's right. Well, often what we'll see is only the sentenced population, after they've pleaded guilty or pleaded out to a lesser sentence, and they have admitted to the domestic violence, then yes, the sentenced population will take those courses, anger management, their behavioral trends, and they learn coping skills. We have everything, including yoga. I mean, we have so many different things to work on these men to change the way they're wired and how they react to stressful situations. So we do everything we can while the batterer is in our care and custody to make them a better person before they leave. We also, and you may know this as an attorney, when you call up to the jail to speak to an inmate, we'll say this line may be recorded. If you're an attorney, hang up and call the other number. We'll hear if there's threats being made and if there's something actionable, we'll work with authorities and the DA. This is what got me going, Susan, is when I saw oftentimes moms coming up with a little toddler in tow to visit the batterer, the boyfriend or husband, because they were afraid. They were afraid if they didn't come up to that jail and put money on his canteen account, boy, they were going to get it when he gets out. They're in big trouble.
Even before when he gets out, friends will threaten it, even if it's a violation of a restraining order. Phone calls, because I see it as an attorney, and I tell my clients, I don't know if I have anybody in your house right now, but I tell them, listen, keep it cool, keep quiet. Everybody's listening. There are cameras everywhere. I know that's not true, but I try to put the fear into them. If you want to get out, you better play by the rules. That doesn't always happen.
What we did was I reached out to Dove, based in Quincy. Domestic violence ended. And I said, would you come up a team and look at our curriculum and tell us what we could be doing better? And they did. And, the other thing we did was we took all of the Dove brochures in every language that they had, and we put them in the visitor lobby because that might be the one opportunity that a victim of domestic violence comes to visit the batterer, sees that, hey, you know what? There is help. And if I just call this number or text this number or call their emergency 24/7 phone line, then maybe I can, you know, get free of this abuse. So, you know, we're doing what we can, but just on the women, and I know this is such a tough subject. Many of the women that are in our care and custody, yes, they've committed crime, but long ago, they were victims themselves. As I talked to them, many of them were abused, just, you know, beaten down, forced into prostitution. Terrible, right. Terrible things happened to them. And so that at some point when they lash out, you know, everyone says, oh, she's not a good mother. She hit her kids.
Not true.
Or she, maybe she fought back and, you know, beat up the boyfriend for a change. But what we're trying to do with our female offenders, the women involved in the justice system, is say, let's look at a diversion program. Start decarceration. I reached out to Judge Coven and I asked him to take a look at a three-phased approach that I want to implement.
Judge Coven is in the Quincy Court, Sheriff?
That's correct, yes.
He's the chief presiding justice, correct?
Correct.
Yeah.
And what we'd like to do is Norfolk County Sheriff's Office would still be responsible for the supervision of the inmate, but that female would be sent to McGrath House on an ankle bracelet.
And McGrath House is what? Halfway house?
It's like a halfway house, a sober home where they could, you know, deal with their anger, talk to a psychologist and a therapist, and you know, we have parenting classes so that we're trying to fix that person. I mean, really, think of it like, I think the easiest way to think of it for people who don't understand the issue is you drop something, you broke it, a coffee mug. You're trying to fix a broken person. What we see as sheriff and what my staff sees, broken men and women, people who are so hurting. And yes, they will do time for the crime, but what were the underlying reasons for them to commit these crimes in the first place? And for the females, oftentimes it's, they snap and they can't take it anymore. They have been abused and treated so poorly that sometimes it's hard for them to even love themselves and respect themselves. Mm-hmm. So what we're working on, this is a really nice program, is we have a partnership with the New England Wildlife Center in Weymouth. And I'll be taking a tour next week. And we have a certificate program, a veterinary certificate program. It's 6 weeks and we've done it for the men. Now we're doing it for the females for the first time.
Fabulous.
Susan, let me tell you, some of the toughest, you know, tough guys with tattoos and, you know, the gang affiliated. And you say, there's no way you could rehabilitate these guys. Well, after 6 weeks of working with animals, a turtle that's been run over, fawn that's been shot with an arrow, a little flying squirrel, a baby raccoon. I went down there and I've been there multiple times, but you'll see a tough inmate feeding like baby formula through a droplet to a little baby squirrel. And he's talking to it like it's a child, you know, and that whole hard exterior melts away. They start caring it and nurturing another living creature. And I know it's going to work wonders for our females.
Oh, I hope you videotape this tour.
Well, we will.
All of us to see.
It's great.
I'm assuming you get releases from the inmate. Sheriff, I know you've done other things at the jail with the administration and the staff, such as promoting diversity big time and with a sense of urgency. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So it goes back to my earliest days. The person who really opened the door for me to get into politics was a person of color. He was the first African-American council president, a gentleman named Bruce Bowling.
Right.
The Bowlings, I used to say, the Bowlings are the Kennedys of Roxbury. And Bruce Bowling gave me my start. And way back in 1993, 92 and 93, Bruce and I were working on issues about disparities in healthcare. We were working on issues about, equity and in education. So I got my start early, and my heroes in the civil rights era were RFK and MLK. Any position I've ever held, whether I, you know, executive director of Habitat for Humanity, which I've done, mm-hmm. or chief of staff at DCAM, Division of Capital Asset Management Maintenance, where I had 370 staff, I've always made sure there's an officer of diversity and inclusion. when I got to be sheriff, I looked around after my second week and I pulled aside the deputy superintendent, Carter Holmes, person of color. And I said, Carter, can I speak with you a minute? He said, sure, what is it, Sheriff? I said, it's not lost on me that there's like zero diversity here. It's like non-existent. And, you know, he kind of chuckled about it. He says, yeah, he goes, it's a problem. And I said, I think diversity for the previous administration was hiring somebody whose zip code wasn't Quincy. and we had a laugh about it. But then I said, no, seriously, Carter, I need you to step up and do this favor for me. I need you to be my diversity officer. I want to cast a wide net and make sure that all positions, not just the position of corrections officer, but all positions in this administration, that you are casting a wide net. I want to hire more women. I want to hire more people of color. More languages need to be spoken here. And so we did. And we put on two classes through the academy. We hired the largest number of female officers ever. We hired the greatest number of people of color in seven different languages, Susan. So
wow.
We have in 22 months added more diversity probably than has happened in 20 years. And we're
oh
not
my God,
stop.
Congratulations on that.
Yeah, we're not going to stop.
Anything. Right.
Yeah, no, I like to, you know, think that we have made a lot of reforms that needed to be done. And we've implemented some forward-looking programs like a task force on juvenile mental health and substance use.
I was just going to ask you about that, juvenile offenders. Do you have any at the jail? No.
No. The youngest I've seen up there is about 19. But you know, even then, what we're learning about people's cognitive development, you know, guys 22, maybe even up to 24, when you talk to them, sometimes it feels like you're talking to somebody who's about 13 or 14 years old. So I don't think they're fully, you know, developed, you know, their capacity to understand everything is just not there. But that's a whole other topic for another day. But for our youth, when I do talk with the offenders, there was one guy that I really had a bond with. His name was Elijah. And Elijah is now in the Painters Union. He's doing great. He was 26 years old. And when I met him, we talked about, you know, how did you come to be here in Norfolk County? And he said, well, about 9 years old is when I first started. He said, my dad was selling drugs out of the front seat of the car. And I watched my dad sell drugs in Dorchester. My dad gave me my first marijuana cigarette. And I got high at 9 years old with my dad. And all I wanted to be was like my dad. And he said, my father would say, don't be like me, son. Don't be like me. Well, mom and dad split up and Elijah was shipped to live with an aunt in Mississippi, then an uncle in Florida, both places he was beaten, not treated well, back to the streets of Boston, then to Norfolk County and to Randolph. And by the time I met Elijah, he was 26 years old, unemployed, dealing drugs to feed his own drug habit, and had two children with two different women. And, you know, his life wasn't going anywhere. So we worked with him, and I have a prison minister. He's non-denominational, and he's a person of color. I brought him in specifically. He's also a Chelsea City councilor named Calvin
wow.
Brown.
Wow.
And I said, Calvin, I want you to talk to these young guys. And, you know, I said, don't hit him over the head with a Bible. You know, that's not going to work. But many of our guys are either Roman Catholic or Protestant. We have very few Jewish inmates and very few Muslim inmates. Number one is Catholic. Number two would be Protestant. But I said, go around and talk to the offenders and see if you can just talk about redemption and second chances and paying back your debt to society and saying sorry to those who you hurt, including your family. So he worked with Elijah, and I'll tell you, I saw a change in that guy. By the time Elijah left, I knew he was going to succeed. And he said, Sheriff, don't take this the wrong way, but I hope to never see you again. And I said, I know. I said, Elijah, I hope to see you on the outside, and I hope to see you happy and successful. And he said, yeah. He says, I'm going to be a real man, and I'm going to take care of my children.
Wow. So, you have a special task force, don't you, on mental health and abuse with parents and teachers and school committee. Am I correct?
That's heard about yes. It. Yeah. That's our task force that we launched. And it was the, for the reasons I just mentioned, Susan, a guy like Elijah started taking up drugs and alcohol at 9 years old. And because so many of our men and women that are incarcerated started self-medicating, because I don't think that their underlying mental health issues were adequately addressed when they were 9, 10, 11, 12 years old. So by the time they're junior high and high school, they realize pretty quick that, hey, if I smoke or if I drink or if I take this pill, all those problems go away. My anxiety, my depression, my schizophrenia, bipolar, they're self-medicating. And many don't make it through high school, and they get involved, you know, with the police and the courts. And it's a very common theme. So to try to break that cycle of dysfunction, I said, let's reach out to all 28 communities in Norfolk County and form a task force on juvenile mental health and substance use disorder. We've got nurses, teachers, parents, school committee members. And I asked for one person from each of the 28. Some communities sent 4 people. They were so excited to get on this task force. And we were meeting monthly before COVID-19. Now we meet through Zoom, and it's like every other month. But what we'd like to do is come up with a position paper so that we could share best practices. You know, what is Brookline or Braintree doing that maybe Bellingham isn't doing?
Right.
You know, some of these communities are hurting financially.
Especially now.
Dover is well equipped, and you know, they can afford social workers for the kids in the school. Westwood, where I live, has, you know, an adequate number of counselors for the student body. But other communities, it's a teacher who's doing music or history, and then he or she is also then the counselor. You know, it's not fair to the kids.
Right.
Every school district deserves the proper funding to have a robust youth and family service group. And so one thing that we're looking at right now, Susan, is we want to reach out to the Attorney General and see if there's some of the settlement money coming from these big pharma companies that like Purdue Pharma, who helped fuel this opioid crisis, and say, you know, for some of our school districts, can we have enough money every year so that we have adequate number of social workers in the schools dealing with these kids and getting them the help that they need? Because if not, they become unruly, they get labeled the disruptive kid, they get suspended. And you've heard the expression school to prison pipeline.
And
it's not that far-fetched when you see what happens if you have, and it's typically boys, they may have ADHD or whatever their issues, they are not able to self-discipline. So they are disruptive.
Right.
Teachers can't deal with them. They get suspended. They're out on the street.
Yep.
Only a matter of time before they interface with the police. Now they're court involved. The criminal history begins.
That's
it. There you have it.
Sheriff, how has COVID impacted everything that you're doing? I'm sure it has. It's probably made it much more complicated.
Oh, so much. It's impacted us so much. We were fortunate before COVID hit to have purchased these sanitizing guns, where it's a fine mist. Think of an Alka-Seltzer tablet. We have these pellets that we drop in with water, and we have electrostatic guns that spray the mist, so it doesn't just drop to the ground. It actually will go around the handle and doorknobs. We had bought 7 of those before COVID hit, and boy, was I lucky we had placed that order.
How did you know to do that?
Did you know
COVID was coming?
I didn't know COVID was coming, but I have a sister. I'll credit my sister, who serves on the Board of Health in Dedham, and she's a nurse. And she said, you know, when you're up there, you know, in that environment, you know, there's high rates of tuberculosis, and you know, you have to make sure everyone's vaccinated and watch out for a bad flu season. So I was thinking about, you know, cleanliness and sanitizing anyway.
And then
COVID hit, and we became cleaning and sanitizing zealots nonstop, every shift. Nobody could find some PPE, personal protective equipment for our officers. I ended up sending a van up to New Hampshire. We bought it direct. We couldn't wait for CDC or DPH. Everybody was saying they were going to deliver. I had to protect my staff and my inmates. So we got our PPE, and then we did get a shipment thanks to Governor Baker working with the Kraft family.
Right.
We got a major shipment of masks, of the KN95s. And so we were doing great. But one thing I noticed was some of the inmates are indigent and they weren't buying enough hygiene products, and they have little bars of soap. But I said, this isn't the time to skimp on little bars of soap. I went to Ocean State Job Lot in Norwood and I asked them, how many cases of Dial antibacterial soap would you sell me? And they said, well, what's it for? I said, I'm the sheriff and I run the jail and house of correction, and I can't always properly socially distance these guys. I need to not have an outbreak. And the manager said, we'll say as many as you want. He was really good. So I bought them out, and I bought them out of my own money because there's no time to set up Ocean State Job Lot as an approved vendor. So I just said, to heck with it. And the guys loved it. And I went around to all the housing units, and one of the inmates was very funny. He says, you know, Sheriff, I've got sensitive skin. Next time, could you get me Dove for Men?
Sheriff, you've also done something with no cost family phone calls. And I know as an attorney, my phone bill, it skyrockets. It's outrageous. Could you explain that a little bit?
Sure. That's really helpful. When I got there, I inherited a phone system with a group called GTEL.
Yep.
And it's 16 cents for a local call and, I'm thinking 38 cents for maybe long distance. But I immediately, when COVID hit and we couldn't have contact visits, I knew that was a climate issue. That could get the inmates very angry. I don't want them to fight with each other or lash out at my officers. So to keep the climate cool, I gave every inmate three stamped envelopes and writing materials so they could write to loved ones. But I also said, look, let's give at least 15 minutes free. And then I bumped it up to 30 minutes free just to call loved ones and stay in touch because they couldn't have visits. But my next step, Susan, the contract with GTEL ends the end of October. Right. We have a new group coming in that's taking over that contract. And when we do the switch over, I'll be the first sheriff to go free local calls.
Good.
So the inmates will be able to work on family reunification because that's so important for successful reentry, is that they, rebuild those bonds with the family and rebuild the trust.
Sheriff, is it fair to say that the only contact inmates have right now due to COVID, and now supposedly there are little cluster spikes, is through the phone and letters?
And we do have visits, but they are not contact. So we have plexiglass. We're allowing limited non-contact visits so that people are coming up and seeing their sons or their brothers or their husband and their daughters and wives. But it's temperature scans for everybody.
Right.
Have to have a temperature scan. We have the CDC DPH posters up everywhere, so that we can ask people, do you feel any respiratory tightness, shortness of breath, cough, fever, aches, And then we have hand sanitizer everywhere, except we have to be very careful with some of our inmates who were trying to drink the hand sanitizer because of the alcohol content, right? Oh. So here we are trying to keep the COVID virus out. But you always have to remember, in a correctional setting, these inmates are very smart, and there's still the craving for alcohol and drugs. So
we have to be careful
with the hand sanitizer because of the alcohol content.
And I know we're very fortunate in Norfolk County because I know you work closely with DA Morrissey, with say the Brookline Police, with probation, with the courts. There's a chain of resources, particularly for domestic violence incidents, that goes from local right up to the county, and we're very grateful for that. In the last couple of minutes, is there anything you would like to say or ask of our audience? How can we help you?
Well, Susan, thank you again for having me on. And the one thing I would ask is to the audience, the position of sheriff is the least partisan position in government. Most of my life I've been a Democrat. then I was independent, and then I was appointed by Charlie Baker, a Baker Republican. I would just say to folks, when they go out there to the polls and they go to vote on November 3rd, to remember to keep the reformer at the jail, Sheriff Jerry McDermott, number one on the ballot. I'd be honored to continue on.
Sheriff, continue the good work, particularly for women. The biggest takeaway I have is that women don't have to go to Framingham for minor offenses. That is huge. For That's 30 right. years, we've been screaming for that in the courts. Thank you so much. We wish you all the best.
Thank you.
And please come back again. We'll Thank you, it, Corbin.
Susan. Thank you for the work you do, Susan.